नमस्कार। राम, अ किंग ऑफ अयोध्या, अ किंग हु लिव्ड फेयरली मॉडेस्ट लाइफ। ही डिडंट शो एनी मिरेकल्स और लीला एंड डिडंट टेक क्रेडिट ऑफ एनीथिंग इन लाइफ, येट ही इज वर्शिप्ड एज अ रोल मॉडल, द आइडियल किंग एंड ही इज लुक्ड अप टू आफ्टर सो मेनी सेंचुरीज। कृष्ण ऑन अदर हैंड showed miracles and leelas at various stages of his life. His birth itself was a miracle. Many instances in Krishna's life made him godly. He lifted a mountain on a little finger as a child, killed all the knights sent to him by his own uncle, and mesmerized Vrindavan with his Ras Leela. But Ram, he never showed us any leelas. Then why is he worshipped as a god? He didn't use any aerial vahan or viman to go to Sri Lanka like other godly personalities in Indian stories do. He went by foot. Imagine, from Ayodhya to Lanka by foot. Ram didn't win the war single-handedly. He took the help of vanaras. Other gods would have won it single-handedly with their powerful weapons. He was like a common man with the resource of a common man. What makes him a godly personality then? It is his qualities that inspired people. People of India relate themselves with him in all aspects of their lives. Ram was an ordinary man, but what he did, only gods can do. He resembles the possibilities similar to a common man. He is a perfect example as to how to conduct life's various activities. He was equanimous in all situations, samatvam, balanced. He kept nyaya, dharma, as superlatives. His main focus was always dharma. Dharma means responsibilities and duties. Nyaya for his kingdom and every creature. Some of his gunas, qualities, we should remember always in our life. And they are, first, righteousness. Ram never lied or behaved in a wrong way. Dharma or responsibility was the fourth front of Lord's life. Understand this incident. When Ram broke Shiva's bow, he didn't accept Sita immediately for the marriage. He said it should be King Dashrath who would be deciding who should be his wife. He only followed the order of his guru, Rishi Vishwamitra. Second point, satisfaction. One gun which each one of us lack nowadays is satisfaction or santosha. Ram was always satisfied with whatever he had and accepted it gracefully as a gift of God. He was self-sufficient. Even during Vanvas, he was satisfied, accepted his life away from his kingdom. His Ayodhya, his kingdom, was his right to rule, yet he accepted Vanvas happily. This Ram's attitude of letting go, or vairagya, and satisfaction, santosh, contentment, made Ram true Maryada Purushottam. Third, loyalty. Another quality that we see in Ram, that he never thought of any other woman than Sita throughout his life. During that era, when Ram was there, kings used to have many wives. His father also had 3 wives. But Ram, at the time of marriage itself, took a vrat, which was Ek Patni Vrat, total loyalty towards one wife. He followed that throughout the life. Now that's the quality which we adore. Fourth, kindness, compassion, karuna. He was a kind soul who wished well for every creature on earth, not just his kingdom. There is one incident in Ramayana where it is mentioned that Ravan sent 2 spies named Shuka and Charan to see how much his strength of the army is and what Rama is good at. These spies were caught by the Ram's army. When Vibhishan came there, Vibhishan recognized them, and then he felt that they might face death now. But to his surprise, Ram was kind to them. Ram humbly spoke to them and then requested them to go. Fifth, gratefulness. Ram was always modest and alluring, and it was seen in the ways that he was always grateful. After defeating Ravan, Ram wholeheartedly thanked Vanaras for their help. Lord Ram also expressed that he was indebted to Lord Hanuman for his selfless service nearing his death. Sixth, leadership quality. Lord Ram had mastery over all subjects. He had a knowledge of astra, weapons, being a kshatriya, and the shastras, the Vedas. He thus is rightly described as a Vidwan. He guided numerous peoples in their lives to find their duties, their dharma, and harmonize with nature and society. Seventh point, calmness. Through many instances, Ram showed true calmness, balance, peace in his personality. Ravan was a learned Brahmin himself. He was an ardent devotee of Lord Shiva. Ravan had pleased Lord Shiva by his devotion to an extent where Lord Shiva had bestowed Ravan with his Atma Ling. Even then, Lord Ram is worshipped. The only difference is that Ram's ability to remain calm, balanced, composed, even in the most fiercest, most difficult situation. Lord Ram is said to have complete control over his emotions, and that too anger. 8. Selflessness. During the war, when Ravan attacked, Ram was patient, far away from being angry. However, the moment Ravan attacked Hanuman, Lord Ram started to fight with Ravan and eventually defeated. Lord Ram never got angry when he was abused. Ram only fought when his devotee or his kingdom was hurt. 9th point, radiance. It is said that when Hanuman's eyes fell on Ram's face, Hanuman was totally shaken. His bones were melting. He felt goosebumps all over his body, and tears of joy and love started flowing automatically through his eyes. This is the tejas, or the radiance. Ram was full of love and radiance. He bestowed love and kindness to everyone, irrespective of whether they had wronged him or not. We all have tragedies in our life and limitless problems. So Ram also had all these in his life, but he chose equanimity, samatvam. Ram chose dharma above everything else. We ourselves, under the difficult circumstances, get so quickly agitated on the lightest issues. We are always complaining somebody didn't respond to our calls, or somebody didn't pay attention to us, somebody didn't appreciate our hard work, and all such forms of incidences. In a way, we are all walking bottles of soda, wasting fizz, or rather energy, over all the minor aspects of our lives. To be worshipped or to be God, we do not need any form of magic. Being extraordinary in the ordinary by doing dharma and being detached on the results makes us nothing else but godly, like Ram. Namaskar.
Hello, namaste. And in the continued series of this 108 days webinar celebrating the glory of Ramayana, today we will be speaking on this topic, Mata Sita Devi. Sita is the central character of the epic. Not only because she appears from the beginning till the end, but also for the fact that she plays a very important, a very principal role in the story, steering actions directly and indirectly. Her character has been regarded as the touchstone of morality. She has remained an iconic character throughout the epic Ramayana. But Sita's birth is always a question, As mentioned in Adbhuta Ramayana, she was portrayed as the abandoned daughter of Ravana and Mandodari, who was left to die in the box full of jewels, far away from Lanka. But her fate of dying was changed when she was discovered and rescued by King Janaka and his wife Sunaina, who later on become her foster parents. And this happened when they were plowing a field for conducting the yajna. So finding her was also a good omen, because the barren lands of Mithila turned to have a lot of rains and the land turned out to be fertile, which was considered very good omen. So hence, Sita, who was discovered from the land, the Bhumi, her name was also called as Bhumija. And since she was found in a furrow, her name came as Sita. There are different names for Sita. She is the Janaki because she is the daughter of Janaka. She is Maithili because she is the princess of the kingdom Mithila. She is Rama because she is the wife of Rama. And since her father had the ability of transcending this body consciousness, he was named Vibeha. And since this was for her father, she was also given the name Vaidehi, who similarly had the same kind of traits. So she was also called Bhusuta for bringing this good omen, making the land fertile, and being an auspicious symbol. So these are the different names that one can give for Mata Sita Devi. It is believed that Goddess Sita was born under Pushya Nakshatra, an auspicious period in the Hindu month of Chaitra, and Lord Rama was born on Navami Tithi. The birthplace, regarding the birthplace of Sita, that is also disputed. The birthplace of Sita is located at Sita Mathi, Bihar, and it is said that Mata Sita was born at Sita Kund, which is now a pilgrimage site. There is also one place, Janakpur, where in present day we can find it in province number 2, Nepal, which is also described as the Sita's birthplace. There are many other versions which talks about related things related to her birth. In she is also described, the foster daughter for the King Janaka and his wife Sunaina. But in certain scriptures, it has been described that she is also seen as a biological daughter of Janaka. This is described in Ramakrishna Mahabharata, which is also based on the authentic version of Valmiki Ramayana. Later, the story of Sita miraculously appearing in a furrow was inserted in the Valmiki Ramayana. There are some versions of the Ramayana which also suggest that Sita is the reincarnation of Vedavati, where Ravana tried to molest Vedavati and her chastity was sullied beyond Ravana's redemption when she was performing penance to become the consort of Vishnu. So this Vedavati immolated herself on a pyre to escape this lust from the Ravana. But she vowed that she will return in another age and will be the cause of Ravana's destruction, and she was duly reborn as Sita. The Devi Bhagavata Purana also says when Ravana wanted to marry Mandodari, Maya warns him that her horoscope indicated that her firstborn would destroy the clan and will be killed. Ignoring the Maya's advice, Ravana buries his first child by Mandodari in a casket in the Janaka city, where it is discovered and she grew up as Sita. Sita is worshipped as the incarnation of Lakshmi, the consort of Vishnu. The Sita Navami marks the birth of the goddess Sita. Sita Jayanti also holds a great significance, especially for the married women who observe fast to seek long lives for their husband. Sita is considered to be the incarnation of this goddess Lakshmi, birthed in the kingdom of Mithila in the Treta Yuga. It is believed that one who observes fast on the Sita Jayanti is blessed with the contented married life. When we talk about this character Sita, she symbolizes the Eastern, particularly the Indian concept and ideology of the inner strength, the spiritual strength, and the beauty. Sita, she has undergone so many trials and tribulations in her life, but still she has emerged as a role model for endurance, self-assertion, despite many failings in her life. Her endurance need not to be taken as weakness. She grows out of this stereotypical framework and she emerges as the self-actualized woman. And if you are going by the Jung's theory of individuation, Sita reaches the level of the self-actualization as she knows herself fully and does not expect the other characters to watch, say, for her character. This is where the influence on women's thinking remains potent, even in the present generation. She remains as a leading ideal, an iconic character till date in India. Not just in India, even in our native land, Sita has remained a source of inspiration for single parents to face the challenges in life. In the foreign countries like USA, where the single parent culture is more prominent, the mothers cite the examples of Sita for her chaste living so that the younger generation can be guided to uphold the certain ethical values. This becomes imperative at a time when there is a moral degradation due to a change in the value system. Some of the characters like Sita, Savitri, remain in the ethical frame of reference. Sita is not seen here as a victim, but she has to be, her character has to be understood as a woman of enormous strength and the fortitude. She represents the parameters that is required for a woman to be called as an ideal woman. And those qualities include assertiveness, beauty, courage, righteousness, loyalty, devotion, ability to question when someone deviates their path of righteousness, and self-respect endowed with the presence of mind and the practical wisdom. Sita is seen as the woman of steel, who is never submissive, who is differential but not decided. She has the inner strength, which we can call it as the spiritual strength. This spiritual strength, which she uses to carry her convictions with immense courage and dignity. The character Sita can be seen in many ways of how it can serve as a role model in the variety of ways. The first thing that we can talk about the Sita's character is all about her independent spirit. The way she lived her life, the way she conducted herself, even in the remote past, all on her terms, by her own rules. Though Sita, she is represented as the most beautiful wife and daughter, a dependent woman. In reality, she was not that. She was not at all dependent on anybody. She had the ability and the courage to question anyone about anything and everything without fear, which made her stand apart from the rest of the society. Though in the whole epic of Ramayana, she is picturized, portrayed as a very submissive, a very fragile kind of person, she is not that. She may look a very submissive figure, but she speaks out powerfully in favor of or against any principle. Sita in the Ramayana is portrayed as the embodiment of the nature. She sprung from the earth And if you look at the climax of the Ramayana, in the end of the Ramayana, she is also seen that she returns back to the earth. Similarly, like how we see a plant which is born from the mother earth and then it sheds itself back and withers back into the same earth. And if you look at her life, majority of her life is spent living in the forest. So, she is Vanakanya, the forest lady. Her life is out of the ordinary, unparalleled, in comparison to a normal woman. When this incident took place, where this exile picture in the Ramayana comes, the mandara, the female maid, incites this Kalki, which brings up the exile of Rama, which is the central theme of the Ramayana. This evidently brings the Sita into the play. Sita is nowhere in the picture. If she decided, if she wanted, she could have stayed back in the kingdom, enjoying the comforts of life, and I would have allowed the husband to go to the exile. But no. She forces, there's a whole conversation between herself and her husband, where she compels her husband to take her along with him. It is where we could see that Sita comes into the play of the Ramayana, where she is the one who initiates the self-exile with the Rama. Rama is given the exile, Sita is not given the exile. The self-exiling thing, the Sita herself initiates. From then on, it's no more a Ramayana, it's more of a Sitayana. It becomes the story of Sita. In the tougher times of life, this very her decision gives us an understanding that in tougher lives of time, she still knew her duties. She still chose the things that was not about the comfortability of the life, but all about the way of leading the life in the most rightful manner. She was a strong, a very determined lady who decided her fate and decided to face it also. She did not acknowledge the detrimental of the society when she was questioned about her character. Her life in the Chitrakuta, Dandaka, Panchavati forest, and also finally in the Ashoka forest where she was imprisoned by Ravana, becomes the major events of the Ramayana. When we look at our marriage thing, the marriage of Rama and Sita is very different from that of Rama's father. When we look at these two people, Dasharatha and Rama, two things are very evident regarding the marriage system. Dasharatha was into a polygamy thing and Rama was into a monogamy marriage institution. Rama is seen as a most devoted, most loyal husband for Sita, who followed this monogamy. Monogamy is the ekapatni vratastha. While pativratya, the loyalty of a wife to the husband for a woman, is established in when we look at the quality of the marriage. Quality of the marriage in the sense whether it is a monogamy or a polygamy. The Ramayana has an effect, brings forward the idealness of this ekapatni vrata. For a man has a cherished idea, where Rama represents the quality by conducting himself as the ekapatni vrata, the vow of the monogamy, and holds on to this vow despite all the difficulties of his marriage to Sita. A closer look and trying to understand the marriage system from the viewpoint of this epic Ramayana, this epic depicts the struggles of women with both the kind of institution, that is polygamy as well as the monogamy. Women have faced the greatest reshaping forces of the civilizing mission, both in these kind of marriage institutions, while trying to adapt themselves to the patriarchal society. Unlike the polygamy, the monogamy demands an unquestionable loyalty of a woman to her husband. And at that same time, it also demands an unflinching loyalty of a man to his wife, which might lead to an excessive jealousiness between the partners. But in the case of polygamy, the jealousy is not between the wives and the husband. So here it is already mentioned wives, but between the jealousy is not between the wife and the husband, but it is between the wife and the co-wives. And one can find such examples of this kind of jealousy in other stories of Ramayana, especially in, when we are talking about Dasharatha, who is Rama's father. He is a polygamous husband, but he does not promise his wife the loyalty, the wealth, and the comfort that a wife deserves for. While his son, who follows this monogamous institution of marriage system, promises his wife only the loyalty. He loves and he is loyal to his wife. In summary, if you think, our epics haven't been kind to the fate of our heroes. And Sita is no exception. A story is made up in extremes. She is abandoned by her biological parents. She is found as a childless king. She is found by a childless king who raises her as his own. So her identity is shaped by the upheaval caused by the times and circumstances. In the pre-modern era, women had always been considered subjects of conquest, who do not have control over the family she was raised in, and the same is the condition when she gets married as well, where she does not have the control over the family she gets married in. And the same is the case with the Sita. As she could marry a man who could string the bow of the Lord Shiva, she was given away as a trophy to whoever made a successful display of the strength. Though definitely Sita longs to marry Rama, she takes an instant liking towards the moment she sees him. But she does not have the privilege to assert herself. What she can do? She can only wait in an anticipation that somehow Rama will understand her desire of longing to him and will do the needful. Sita has another limitation. She is known being the daughter of King of Janaka. That means she belongs to a royal family. Hence, she has to partake in the ways of royalty and enact the role of an obedient daughter, because many of them will look up to her, and hence she has to become a symbolic character depicting certain values and cultures in her life. So this lesson of obedience she learns from her childhood, and she lives, which helps her in her later life to become the most patient wife. Thus, from daughter to wife, Sita is initially known in relation to men. But for the first time, Sita in this epic chooses to identify herself. When was that? Till then, she was doing the duties that were concerned and to be done by a daughter as well as a wife. But when she starts doing, she starts taking independent decisions, in fact, she makes a decision that she has to accompany her husband along with him in the exile. She decides to live as a hermit with her husband in the forest, and she's not afraid of letting go. She gives up a life of privilege for Rama. In this regard, she is no less than a heroine. She is more like a heroine of any modern tale who just follows her heart over the logic, the stringent standards of reason. Sita's perception of the self evolves over the years. She is definitely an obedient daughter who could never spell out her desire for a young man. She could not put to shame her proud heritage and hence waits for the divine intervention when it comes from Mani Rama. But still, she chose over the period that eventual evolvement can be seen, that initial submissive and obedient Sita, as her life moves on, she tends to bring her unique personality out. She chooses to take the matters into her own hands. And when separation from her husband becomes a threatening reality, she did not want her fate to decide for her. She wanted to decide the next course of her life. This epic often facilitates between a pre-modern narrative and a modern one in relation to the Sita's life. Sita is independently giving primacy to one identity. If you look at her, she has released herself from the bondages of her daughter, and now her total prominence that she is giving, the total prime importance that she is giving, is for that one character, that is of her wife. She is independently giving that primacy to one identity of hers, that is her wife character, over another, that of her princess, and demonstrates how she gradually can become more assertive about her choices in life, and that is how this epic starts developing. She chooses her marriage over the power in an empire which was coveted by many. Sita does not lust for power, but seen through the critical lens, however, she has been rendered morally suspect if she did not choose the hardship over the appearance. She is the ideal wife, and in order to earn the society's reverence, she must wish upon herself the misfortune that had befallen Rama. She knows internally that she is capable of. Many of the women, even now, they are caught by this kind of obligations. They are not more educated than men. They are they cannot have a better social status than men. Somewhere the woman voluntarily tries to suppress herself. This is what that Sita also did. Though she had no personal ambitions, and internally she was capable enough lady, a very strong lady, she still chose to surrender to her husband, wishing that her actions would not hurt the ego of her husband. Her trust on her husband that he will help her in times of crisis. So, and also in order to earn the reverence from the society, she had to forcibly wish upon herself those misfortunes that had befallen the Rama. Sita longs to domesticate in the forest. It so happens that she longs to domesticate the golden deer she spots where she was there in the forest. So this gives us an understanding that sometimes she is not a woman who is trying to suppress her voices, especially in terms of her desire. She is not ashamed of putting out those things. So this longingness of domesticating that golden deer, she gives us her another phase of how she is voicing for her deer, her desires. And this is an insistent on acquiring of what she longs for. When we look into the Ramayana epic, the weakest of Sita's representation in all the tellings and retellings of Ramayana is where when Ravana abducted Sita and kept her captive, she waits there like a beautiful wife to be rescued by Sri Rama. When she herself was capable, able enough to free herself from the captivity of Ravana. In this case also, she was not trying to hurt her husband's ego, and she trusts that her husband will save her from the misery, and she chooses to be liberated by Sri Rama. This proves how the power is rendered useless if it is not exercised to improve the condition of the subject. The subject must be in a position to exercise power without restraints. But if it so had happened, like if Sita had escaped Lanka by the virtue of her own merit, the way she has been depicted in the Ramayana would have been modified. The factors like courage, strength, and power, which should function irrespective of the gender, especially in the case of Sita's abduction, and if Sita would have taken the efforts to escape and free herself from this situation, it would have definitely threatened the structures of the male-dominated institutions. For Ramayana to take place, Sita had to inflict the hardship upon herself to maintain the stability in the patriarchal system. Sita had to be known as Rama's wife. That would not have been possible if by her marriage, she would have avoided all the troubles of her life. In our society, a woman is, if you look at Sita's condition, where she had to give Agni Pariksha and all, in our society, a woman is not accepted as wife if she has spent an extended amount of time in the company of a man who is not her husband. Her purity, her loyalty will be questioned. She is given an image of a reused object, and in the case of Sita, who has undergone through such situation, her skill does not suit her husband Rama, who has a king's stature to accept her. Rama is disturbed by this. He is disturbed by the rapid conjecture by the gossip mongers. He sends Sita away to a dreaded forest. She is asked not to identify as Rama's wife anymore. So, if you look at her character from a princess to becoming a royal queen, she is left to an identity where she is no more a wife, no more a queen. And at that time, she gives birth to Rama's twins, who cannot claim the parentage. But even in such a drastic situation, she never questions her lack of identity. She still considers herself to be the Rama's wife. Her self-perception is an autonomous from the social norms. Abandonment comes back into Sita's life this time, but it takes a more formidable shape. And after a considerable time that passes off, Rama is compelled by different kinds of circumstances, and he is at that time willing to take back Sita, but again on one condition, that he wants her to walk through that fire again, the Agni Pariksha. But this time, he makes sure that she has to go through this Pariksha in full public view, that nobody has any doubt on her loyalty, on her fidelity. He wants to silence all his subject. For him, the public opinion matters. He has never behaved like a husband to Sita more, he has behaved like a king for his kingdom. So hence he wants to silence those who have questioned Sita's chastity. It is important for Rama to have a queen that everybody accepts and agrees. It is important for Rama to have a queen of whose image is totally unblemished. He wants to establish himself and Sita as infallible and superhuman. Rama's public morality in this situation supersedes his private morality. But Sita is Sita. She is only playing the character of his the character of Mayu, being Rama alone, she has no other equation, she has no other kind of connections. She is seeing herself as, I am the wife of Sri Rama. So hence her problem is she cannot distinguish between the two, that is the king Rama and the husband Rama. While Rama chooses himself to be portrayed as always king, where he had to be acting as a husband when it comes to the need of Sita, he doesn't. So for Sita, this becomes a very difficult thing. She cannot relate to King Rama, in whom she loses her husband, Rama. Sita always in her life has chosen to be the Ram's wife by avoiding being seduced by hope of royal supremacy, and in the end she is betrayed by Rama and she cannot cope with this Rama's betrayal. What is remarkable about Sita is that she wants Rama, the husband, to know the truth, but she does not want to prove anything to Rama, the king. So she wants to prove her husband, but not the king, the Rama, the role played by her own husband. She has no likings, no inclinations to the power, the authority, and to the comforts of the life. In Ramayana, this can be seen in several instances where she has given up this in several occasions. In the end, when she was asked again for this Agni Pariksha, the last proof for her fidelity, she requests the earth beneath her feet to split and take her within if she had been ever unfaithful to, if she had never been unfaithful to Ram. She is accepted with open arms and cannot be disgraced again. If we look into the character of Sita, Sita has hardly ever stayed within the lines, quite literally if you look at, she has never stayed within the lines. We also know that she crossed the Lakshman Rekha when she was asked to be inside. When she was asked not to fall, come into the exile, she did. She only did what she wanted to do. She was not a lady who was being bounded by this kind of rules being put by the patriarchal society. Her ultimate defiance of social norm gives her more power than her crisis-ridden journey of her life. Sita is not just remembered alone as Rama's fiercely loyal wife, but as a woman who has stood for herself. This would do justice to her saga. Her portrayal for most parts of the Ramayana is weak, it is normative, but her ultimate defiance in the end lets Sita win her lost selfhood. By refusing to succumb to the power-seeking, the gossip-mongering kind, Sita embraces liberation. But it is discomforting that such emancipation is likened to suicide in this epic. Is this the only way a woman can liberate herself from social obligations? By embracing death? What are the consequences of a defiance that a woman must face? Sita, as a character, raises important questions in this regard. Her tale is just a matter of subjective interpretations and reinterpretations that she is set at the stake by choosing to disobey. It is in subversion that Sita has to be remembered. With this, I would like to thank the organizers of the Ramayana Vishwakosha History for giving me this opportunity to talk on the topic Mata Sita Devi. Thank you.